church, wherever you are this morning, we want you to lift your hands and lift your voice and begin to glorify your God. Let your worship and your praise, come on, be an invitation to him right in your living room. Come on, in your bedroom, wherever you are, just begin to lift your voice from the rising of every sun to the going down of the same. The name of the Lord is worthy to be praised. We want you to put your hands together like this. Come on, everybody.
Yes, sir.
Come back here, Lord.
somebody to lift him up while the world is going crazy. I need somebody to lift him up while there's sickness all over the land. I need somebody to lift him up. Open up your mouth and give God the glory. Come on, Have Life. We've come to glorify him today. We've come to magnify him. If you're with us, clap your hands like this. Come on. Come on. That's it. Now get up out your seat. so glad to call him my God. Yes, he is. What a mighty God he is. Hallelujah. And we honor him today. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands up. Lift your hands in his presence. There's no other name greater than the name of our Lord and our Savior, of our great King. And I'm so glad that I have safety in him in the midst of everything that's going on.
There is a name, that's a place I can run and be safe. There is a name that can heal, calm my storms, peace be still. I can call on that name and be saved, and things will change. Stand and proclaim, there is no greater name than Jesus.
That's a place I can run.
Praise the Lord, everybody. We're so excited that you're joining today. Thank you so much for continuing to worship with us. Listen, I know that we are still at home. I hope that you all are being safe. You're wearing your mask and you're washing your hands. But at this time, we're sending you virtual hugs. Find somebody that you're around. If you got nobody that's around, hug yourself. We're sending you virtual hugs this morning, this afternoon, whenever you might watch this broadcast. We love you guys so very much. Can't wait to see you soon.
Praise God, everybody. This is Pastor Sho here live in the Queen City, Charlotte, North Carolina. And let me tell you, our world has changed in a way that we never thought we would live to see. I mean, this is absolutely crazy, the pain that is being expressed. One thing that I am is unapologetically Black. Amen, everybody. The truth is, as a Black pastor, there's sometimes some moments when you have to speak. So don't turn me off. Don't go anywhere else. You need to hear this dialogue that we are about to have. I could have done this and recorded this and spoken this anytime during the week, but I believe it deserves the Sunday morning crowd, to be honest with you. And I really thought about calling on a white pastor to come and have dialogue with me. But to be honest with you, I think that's systemically wrong. I feel like they should call me to ask me to come talk to their congregation about what's going on, rather than me call them and say, can you come talk to us? And even the conversations that I've had, the question is, well, what are you all doing? And my answer is getting beat. That's what we're doing, getting shot. The question is, what are you doing to help these crimes against humanity? And so I want to talk briefly about it today, and then I'm going to open it up, and maybe some discussions will begin. I'm normally slow to speak because I would rather have the information. In my younger years, I was a tad bit more militant, where I would speak out without any facts, let emotions run over, and then have to retract. So while everybody else was kind of running to the front of the line to speak, I pulled back a little bit because I wanted to prayerfully enter into a conversation and a dialogue that would bless, have life. So I want to start by looking at Matthew. Everybody that can. I want to look at Matthew chapter 21. It's going to be on the screen for you. Matthew 21. This by no means set the entire stage, but this is a canvas in which I'd like to begin. Matthew 21, verse 12. Go there as fast as you can. Matthew 21. And we're going to look at verse 12. It says, "And then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all those who were buying and selling in the temple, and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who were selling doves." Verse 13, "And he said to them, it is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a robber's den." And so the reason I want to use this as a canvas to begin this talk, if you will, is because many people misconstrue what the narrative is really talking about. The narrative is about economic justice. That was me. I'm sorry, everybody. Economic justice. It's crazy, everybody, how the world looks at the way things go in the economy and turn a blind eye to what's really going on. We can't do that anymore. Jesus went to the temple, and the reason he turned over tables was because, check this out, everybody, the people would come from far places, and because you were coming to sacrifice, you could not bring all of your sheep. Does that make sense? You could not bring your herds. You could not bring your cattle to make the sacrifice. So what they would do is they would bring money, and then at the temple exchange the money for the sacrificial lamb, so that the sacrificial lamb would be slain. So why was Jesus upset? Because the money changers were cheating the people out of their ability to sacrifice. they were cheating the people, and there was an economic disparity. Because if you were not able to sacrifice, you were considered a sinner and dropped lower in class. So Jesus turned over the tables and said, you are not going to cheat my people economically. So he threw over tables in his anger because he wanted the people of God to come to the temple and be able to exchange properly. So you cannot tell me Jesus never showed any signs that he was upset with the way the government was running. Now listen to me. Let me be clear. I do not condone rioting. I do not condone burning down buildings. I do not condone smashing through windows, and people worked hard to build their businesses. I do not condone burning people's houses and cars and those sorts of things. I believe that is a sin. I believe it is wrong. But the problem is this: when you suppress for so long, there will be an explosion of some degree. Hear me. I'm not condoning it. But what I am saying is, after so much suppression and oppression, there is eventually a response. Yeah, the response is wrong, but there is a response. And it's amazing to me that you have the peaceful protesters during the day and a completely different crowd that comes in at night with the intention of doing some harmful things. And I just don't condone it, but I do say to all of the brothers and sisters that are out there, there's a better way to peacefully express your pain. Some people don't really believe that Jesus was in favor of economic development. Some people don't believe that there is economic suppression and depression and oppression in the United States, and you are absolutely wrong. You have a right to be wrong, but you are really wrong when it comes to that. Okay, let me make you mad real quick right through here. Name a third generation rich black person. Name a somebody's rich today and their grandfather was rich. Can you do that? Are you able to do that? How many of those are out there? Here's the truth. Then let's go second generation that's black or minority and rich outside of sports and entertainment. The truth is, black people, black and brown people, have just now been given the opportunity to have money. We're the first generation of black and brown people who can claw their way to the top in real estate, in law, in medicine, in engineering, in architecture. We're really the first generation to be able to do that or accomplish that. Name how many granddads are rich? Remember, they grew up in Jim Crow. Wasn't allowed to have money. Because the truth is, a black or brown person can go to the bank, go to the car dealership, same credit score or better, same work history or better, and still be denied. So if you don't believe it's, again, y'all know me, I try to preach love. I'm trying to hug everybody. I'm mad I can't hug everybody now. I try to preach love, but at some point I got to identify with the pain of the people I pastor. It's amazing when you really look at it. The fact that you look at old money, black folk don't have old money. we have new money at best, or trying to get to new money. We don't have the privilege. We were denied long-term insurance, which a lot of white people were able to get, but their grandfathers were able to get insurance and put up trust. We weren't able to put up trust so our grandchildren would have money perpetually rolling down. And it's still happening. Even churches, check this out, everybody. Churches, y'all heard this on the news. Churches were given the PPP loans. All you had to do was apply for it. Every church in the country applied, and we are one of them. Trying to get some financial relief, and disproportionately black churches were denied. We bank with one of the biggest banks in the country, and they just gave us the runaround, the runaround, the runaround, and they gave this money to other places. They gave out economic money to universities, right? HBCUs didn't get any of the money. How do you know that, Pastor Show? Harvard, thank God for the Harvard Board of Trustees, who said they gave us $9 million unsolicited. Wow. What are you saying, Pastor Show? They gave them $9 million that they did not apply for. And the Board of Trustees says, we have $1 billion in our trust. Take your money back. Wow. I applaud them for giving that money back, so maybe an HBCU would get some of that money. Come on, y'all. This is real. Small businesses weren't getting that money. Nordstrom's did. Big brand stores did. Those that are in power are making decisions regarding minorities, and we've got to come together economically. I know I'm spending a lot of time on money, but I need y'all to understand this is a major driving force. I can't sit here and say we just going to love one another, because love is not getting us where we need to go. Still love, absolutely. Still pray, absolutely. But there's got to be something that happens after the riots end, after the charges are brought, after the police are in jail. There still has to be something that happens, and it has to be some level of economic reform for black and brown people. And watch this, fussing in the barbershops don't change a thing.
Help us.
Fussing at the nail salon, fussing, it doesn't change anything. Can I tell you what'll make a change? Oh my God, here it is. Get 50 grand and pay to go to one of these dinners that the senators are having. Yes. Come on, Jalen. That one of the senators, the governor, the mayor, the city council that they're having, you pay that 50 grand to sit at the table. And just by being in the room, they know you are a person of means and influence. And so whenever you need something, you call them directly.
Yes.
And you say, hey, my business needs this land. Don't let nobody get it. And see, somebody else is trying to get the land, and they won't let it because they got somebody who's in their pocket that's been sowing into their campaign. You got to pay that money to sit at the table.
Yeah.
So they at least know your name and know you are a person of means. Outside of that, what are you going to do? Now, we got to absolutely, I'm a proponent of voting. Don't complain and you're not going to vote.
Yeah.
But we've got to watch the voting system right now. How are we going to vote? How is this going to happen, ladies and gentlemen? We cannot let this just peruse over our minds. We have to make sure that we are paying attention to what happens next. How to change policy. The church, the black church, we are the ones that founded the civil rights movement, the black church. There was no major auditorium where black people were allowed, so they had all of their rallies at church, because church was the only place that black people could gather.
Yeah.
I need y'all to stay with me, because I want you to hear my heart. Charlotte, North Carolina, I believe we are in the process of trying to make sure that the Republican convention doesn't come here. I believe we're on the cusp of absolutely making sure it does not come here. And some people will tell you that it's going to bring millions to the city. The truth is, it will bring millions to the city, but it costs the exact same millions to fix the city after they leave. And this is not a pun against Republicans. It was the same when the Democrats came. The amount of money that the city made when the Democrats came, we spent to get the city back in order. But what I don't agree with our president, I won't speak with ad hominems against our president. You have to honor leadership. I will not degrade him like I feel in my heart at times. I will not speak that, because I'm a man of the Bible, and the Lord would not be pleased if I just called him what I wanted to. Praise our God. You got to pray for him. But our president wants to come to Charlotte and use the Spectrum Center and invite 20,000 people. And his desire is for them to all be unmasked. He wants 20,000 people without masks to just come in and do whatever they want to do. The possibility of Charlotte becoming the new New York is right in our face if we allow this to happen. Come on. We have to have a voice. We have to have a strong enough voice. Check this out, that we have a seat at the table to speak our truth. And if the church doesn't get together, this is the place where the black populace congregates. And us as pastors, us as church leaders, we have to begin to speak. And it's not just up to us. We need our beautiful white brothers and sisters to stand with us and recognize that these are crimes of against humanity. These are crimes against the entirety of mankind. Yes, black and brown people are disproportionately sought out to be harmed, to be disenfranchised. But these types of crimes should be seen as crimes against the entirety of mankind. This is big, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm concerned in my heart with the world that we're raising our children. Many of our members are single. I got people in this room. I got my sons here with me right now. I'm concerned about the world my sons are coming up in. My youngest son is 12. I'm concerned about the world he's coming up in. My oldest son will be 19 soon. I'm concerned about the world he's embarking in. I got a 16-year-old. I'm concerned about the world he'll be driving in. Minister Eddie has a daughter and a son. Deacon Donald has a daughter and a son. Who your kids gonna marry? Let's take it a step further. Who are your daughters gonna marry if all of the brothers keep getting locked up? Who your daughters gonna marry? Because recidivism is real also. The issues in the jail system is real, especially when it comes to mandatory sentencing. And so you got somebody now. Don't get me wrong. I'm not a proponent of illegal drugs or anything along those lines. I'm not a proponent of those things. But you get caught with a joint and you go to jail for 5 years for a joint. Yeah. Like, I'm not saying smoke it. I'm not saying any of that. I'm saying you get caught with a roach clip and you get 3 years for. You can't even get high off of that. You can't even get high. Somebody else. You can't. That don't even work. That little roach, because that don't even work. But you gonna go to, you gonna get 3 to 5 years for that? Come on, somebody. Y'all not being nice to me. But the problem, some of our politicians, come on, let's talk politics. Some of our politicians are talking about making marijuana legal across the country. Yeah. Now, if you make marijuana legal across the country, what about the people that are in jail serving time for marijuana? So if the people that are in jail serving time for marijuana all of a sudden get free, you've had them in there for 3 to 5 years. They have no skill. What are they going to return to? Wow. Wow. They're going to return to the streets. That's all they knew because there's been no real rehabilitation. Are y'all feeling anything I'm saying? Listen. As a black man, I have been emotional every day for about 2 weeks. Sometimes I get up in the morning, I'm just like, I don't even know if I want to watch the news. I don't even know if it's worth my, sometimes I'll talk to co-pastor in the morning. I'm like, okay, I got to get a certain amount of things done. So I should not watch the news first, because then that might throw my day. I'll be upset. I won't be able to write. I won't be able to read. I won't be able to pray. Because when I get on my face to pray, I'm just saying, Lord, please have mercy on us. But. These senseless acts, these deaths, these cover-ups, it's real. I haven't really taken my son to ride our bikes around my neighborhood like I should since Ahmaud Arbery. You know, we used to ride our bikes around the entire neighborhood. I ain't gonna lie, I ain't make it all the time. I didn't make it. There's a difference between 12-year-old legs and 43-year-old legs. I didn't make it all the time, but I was like, when you get back, we do the loop. And then when you get back, we gonna do the loop. And when you get back, we gonna hit that, go down the hill to the house. Amen, praise God. But the truth is, can I be honest with you? We haven't really been riding that much lately. Because when I get out there, the first thing in my mind is my man safe? Wow. Can't let him go anywhere where I can't see him. Is he safe? I'm standing in the street looking. If you can't go if I can't see you. So now I'm putting my issues on him. He just wants to be free and ride his bike, but I've got to teach him at too early of an age how to say hands up, don't shoot. I got to teach him at an early age why he can't ride his bike where I can't see him. Let me be clear. I do not believe, and I'm done after this. If y'all have something you want to say, I want to open it up. I do not believe that every police officer is shady. I don't believe that. I do not believe that. We have some amazing police officers in this city. Our sheriff, Sheriff McFadden, is a friend of Have Life Church. I get emails from him. I can call him when I need to. We honored the police last year, and the police chief, the deputy police chief, was able to come and be a part of our congregation, and we honored them and thanked God for them, and we prayed for them. So we understand. Ever since, check this out, ever since the massacre in Charleston, we have had a sheriff or a police officer at every Sunday morning service without fail, because I believe in protecting the house. I want to protect the house, and I want to honor them. So I'm going to be clear. I do not believe that all of them wake up in the morning trying to figure out how to hurt us. That's not God either. To think that all of them are bad, that's not God either. But the truth is, there are some that are infecting the others. And we have to put pressure on our government and our officials to make sure they weed those people out. But to see a grown man having the life choked out of him to the point where he's begging for his mother. To watch that, you have to know that there's a problem. And I'm gonna be honest with you, silence is the same as condoning at this point. You have to speak. You have to say something. You have to let your voice be heard. I'm talking to all of our white brothers and sisters. You have to say something now. You cannot allow us to continue to be abused like this. We have a moment where a couple people may want to share. Is that the case? Deacon Donald, share with us, sir.
Thank you, Pastor, first and foremost, for the opportunity to speak. As you said, I do have a small daughter, small son, and the thing that grips me the most is every day when I walk in the house coming in from work, or you know, when we were outside of COVID-19, my son likes to run up to me and say, "Daddy," and run and give a big hug. And before I can even get around the corner, when I open the door, he's there to greet me. And it hit me the other day that I am probably going to have to curb his enthusiasm to love people because somebody that doesn't look like him doesn't like him, or even worse, hates him. Mm. And he's 3 years old, and I don't want to take that joy away from him. So for me, and we had this conversation the other day, it's about consequences. That officer thought in his head that he had the power to stick his knee in somebody's neck, and in the back of his head, he thought, "I don't have a consequence. I have the power and the right to do this." Wow. And that is what really grips at me the most, and it causes me to give introspect to myself as a black person and say, what am I willing to do? What are these next steps? Not just blacking out on social media, but blacking into council meetings and public forums and going to where these House of Representatives are so that I can give my voice or give my opinion so that my issues can be heard. So that's where I'm at. I'm kind of at what's the next step action-wise.
I think you said it eloquently. We have to show up. We have to show up. You know, Co-Pastor and I, our background is education. She was a principal. And they would rezone the schools. And everybody would hate the rezoning, especially the black and brown folks. And they would say the same thing. Well, we had a meeting where we discussed it and planned it, and none of you showed up. So we voted, and it just so happens that the whole room was white. And the vote counts, but because we won't take the time to show up at the meetings to at least let our voices be heard. Because, check this out, even if they ignore you, watch this, this is good. Even if they ignore you, you know the name of the person who ignored you, so you cannot vote for them later. You can put their replacement in. But when you look at the ballot, how many names do you know? When you look at the city council, when you look at the school board, when you look at the lieutenant governors, when you look at all those different, when you look at the judges, who the prosecutors, who if you go to court will be coming at you, when you see, do you know any of those people? We have to take some level of interest. So when I say vote, let me back that up. Know who to vote for. You got to know what they stand. You want to know their record. You want to say, okay, so these are the three people that took my child out the school that was doing well and put them in this other school that's not doing so well. These are the people who are redistricting everything. Okay, you all need to know we're going to vote you out. I hope you have something else that you want to do after this because you're gone. But they know we're not going to show up. Do you know how some of these racist people keep their Senate seats? In the House and in Congress, do you know how some of them keep it? Because they've passed laws that we didn't know about that say anyone can vote in any district. So you have a white person whose district is all black and none of the black people even know it. But all the white people voted more than once because it's legal, because you can vote for your district and another district. And they get all their people in power. And we have no clue what's going on because we don't take the time to figure out who's in charge of what. And so I want my sons to know who's in charge of what so you can begin to be empowered. Yeah. Minister Eddie, you had something you want to say, sir.
I have an interesting perspective. I grew up in a predominantly white neighborhood. I went to predominantly white schools. And so I saw things so different when I was growing up. And one of the things that I have to be intentional about now, as we see all of this heartbreak in our society, it almost seems like week after week we have another hashtag, we have another story. And as a young father, I'm sitting there, how can I tell my 7-year-old black son that he's safe to go to school? Mm. We were riding around and it was just me and him. And for a moment, I was really scared for our safety. Now, as a father, that's really difficult because you're supposed to be the protector, the provider. You're the strength. You're the person who's supposed to calm him down. And, you know, my wife is blowing up my phone and I had another call. She couldn't get to me and she panicked. And being in a world where you have to fear a normal trip to the grocery store is a world that pains me that my children have to grow up in. And so growing up in a predominantly white neighborhood, one of the things that I wish happened was the education of it all. I mean, there's moments where I could have to sadly say that as a grown man, I had to go out and find tools to educate myself. What does redlining actually mean? How does that actually affect the school systems? And then how does that affect how people actually get jobs? And how does home ownership affect this entire piece of the puzzle? And education is so key.
Yeah,
our pastors are amazing because they're former educators, so they know that a lot of times our school systems, they shorthand us. They teach us one part of history. And you grow up thinking one side of the narrative, and you don't get the full picture. And unfortunately, there's a lot of black and brown children who do not have the full narrative. So one thing that I've done is try to my best to teach my son honesty, but also teach him hope. Because one thing you don't want to do is start this cycle of hatred that just makes things worse. So as a believer, this is where it's tough for me. How do I teach honesty? And how do I teach hope? How do I teach learning and knowledge, but also teaching the principles that Jesus was also a radical? Jesus also loved all people.
Yeah.
And the balance of both, unfortunately, with so many millennials I see is we post. We're militant. We're angry. We're upset. But even before we're political, we're still believers. And how do we manage the balance of both? And that's where I don't even have the answers for, but I'm trying to get there and then teach the next generation the same thing.
Thank you for that. This is new for all of us. None of us have ever been here. We are living through what future PhDs will write dissertations about. How we handle this will be the dissertation topic of a PhD. How do you handle this? I think we're gonna have to walk it day by day. Teach Jesus, teach hope, but help them understand that everybody doesn't love Jesus. That there's a real enemy we have to fight. And everybody out there is not gonna smile back at you. And we have to continue to share the love of Jesus. But then also we have to teach them to be cautious. And that's the painful part, to be cautious, to look over their shoulder. No, I don't want to teach them to look over their shoulder. Yeah, at this point, you would be an irresponsible dad not to teach them to look over his shoulder. So I wish I had a better answer. But I think that we're journeying through this together. But don't stop teaching hope. Don't stop teaching love. Teach the Bible to them, but you also teach them how to protect themselves and that everybody doesn't love Jesus. Listen, thank you for being with us today. I know this is a service that you did not expect, but it's important that we address the elephants in the room. Prophetic preaching is not simply houses and cars. It's also speaking to the moment that we live in, speaking to the King, speaking in a way that they understand what needs to happen or what thus saith the Lord. And so today was a moment of sobering fact that we believe that we needed for the house. Thank you for listening. At this moment, I'm going to pray for everybody. We have some information that's going to come up on the screen. If you want to give your life to Jesus, that's important to us, absolutely. If you want to become a part of Have Life, that's something that we would love to see. We're going to give you an opportunity to sow. But I want to speak protection over Have Life. I want to speak and pray freedom from fear. For everybody listening to me that's still dealing with the emotions of it, because I am, I'm going to pray for peace. And then right after that, we'll have our opportunity to sow. Thank you for staying with me a little longer than normal, but thank you for staying with me. Father, I pray not only for Have Life, but for everyone in this country, black and brown people everywhere, as well as our white brothers and sisters. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you give us the tools, give us the ability, give us a seat at the real tables so that we can speak in such a way that brings change to this country. I pray for the families that have been directly affected, Floyd's, the Taylors, Aubreys. I pray for their families directly, that even in their grief, you would comfort them. God, help this country to move from problem to solution. And I'm asking, God, that the voice of Christ be heard. But I really ask right now, God, that you would cover black and brown people as we go to the store, as we live our lives, as we work out, as we sleep in our homes, as we jog around our neighborhoods. God, even when we do something wrong, still protect us. Even when we're not in the center of your will, still protect us. And I pray a covering over Have Life and all of our family, all of our friends, all of our partners throughout this country, even abroad, even the world, God. I pray that you would keep us. Bless the children, God. Would you even shield their hearts? Bless our future children. Bless CJ's twins, God. You got twin boys, Lord. Bless Harley, God. She needs a husband that doesn't have a record, God. Bless all of our kids. Bless Elena, Lord Jesus. Bless Andrew, Father. Bless EJ. Look on EJ, Lord. Look on him, God. Let him keep his smile. Look on Charlie, Lord. Look on all of the children of Have Life. God, help us to build a world that they can grow up in love. Give us the way to do it. Give us the way to do it. God, I'm still praying protection over your people from COVID. You would keep us safe as we do our best to practice social distancing, as we do our best to cover ourselves and still go about our daily lives. Let your blood cover. Let your blood keep. I pray for those who are still going through economic difficulty. God, continue to hold them up. Feed your people. Clothe your people. Shelter your people. And I pray, God, that you would keep Have Life safe. In Jesus' name. Amen. Right now, right where you are, I want you to give. The information is up on the screen for you. Please support the house. Please support the house. We tithe. We believe in that. In the beginning of the year, we were asking for tithe plus 20. Yes, I upped it. Tithe plus 40. If you have a job, I love you. Keep supporting the house. Everything we do is because you support us. So I want everyone, I know you're getting ready to jump off. You may be texting to join. You may be texting to give your life to Jesus, but I need everybody to sow a seed. We love you. We appreciate you. We thank God for you, and we're praying for you. See you soon.
What's up, Have Life family? It's your girl, Mel, and these are your weekly announcements. Thank you so much for tuning in today to our online worship experience. We want to remind you that if you want to make the decision to join our awesome ministry, you can do that. Just text JOIN HLC to 28950. And if you're making the incredible decision to dedicate your life to Christ, you can text SAVED HLC to 28950. So in case you didn't hear, we have expanded our viewing times to better serve you and our distance family. Every Sunday moving forward, you can find us on Facebook and YouTube at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and on YouTube at 1 p.m., 5 p.m., and 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. As usual, our youth experience will air immediately following our 9 a.m. service. Parents, it's our desire to keep you in the know with all things youth related. So we have created a parent portal for parents only on Facebook and Instagram. Go follow us now, Facebook and Instagram at Have Life Youth Church. Please make sure you're staying connected with your church family. Meet us every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for Have Life groups. If you haven't done so already, make sure you complete the one-time registration at havelife.net/groups. All right, family, that's all I have for you this week. Be sure to follow us on all social media outlets at Have Life Church, and check in on our website for more updates at havelife.net. Peace.